Chowdhury, CEO, ASI Consulting, the members of advisory committee of the school, Commander Vicky Jetley, hope he will join after some time. He is also a moderator of question and answer for the talk. Head of the our school, Professor A.K. Pradhan, and guest of the evening, Professor Enrico, who is going to talk on the topic, data-driven prognostic and health management for predictive maintenance of industrial component and system. Faculties, the audience, students, and research scholars, I welcome you all for this special talk. Now I request Professor Rajiv Nandan Roy to read biography of Professor Enrico Zio to start this lecture.
Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Enrico Zio received the MSc degree in nuclear engineering from Politecnico di Milano in 1991 and in mechanical engineering from UCLA in 1995, and the PhD degree in nuclear engineering from Politecnico di Milano and in probabilistic assessment at MIT in 1996 and 1998 respectively. He is currently a full professor at the Center for Research on Risk and Crisis, CRC, of Ecole de Mines, Paris Tech, PSN University, France, full professor and president of the Alumni Association at Politecnico di Milano, Italy, eminent scholar at Kyung Hee University, Republic of Korea, distinguished guest professor at Tsinghua University, Beijing, China, adjunct professor at City University of Hong Kong, Weihang University, and Wuhan University. In 2020, he has been awarded the prestigious Humboldt Research Award from the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation, one of the world's most prestigious research awards across all scientific disciplines. The award has been granted for being a world leading scientist in risk and resilience assessment, safety analysis, and reliability engineering of complex systems and infrastructures, in particular for energy applications. He has been one of the pioneers in using artificial intelligence and evolutionary algorithms in reliability engineering and risk assessment, solving key problems related to the safety and reliability of critical systems, such as those used in the nuclear, oil, and gas transportation industries. In 2021, he has been nominated ambassador of 4TU Center for Resilience Engineering, that is 4TURE, the Knowledge Center in Resilience Engineering of the four universities of technology in Netherlands, that is Delft University of Technology, Eindhoven University of Technology, University of Twente, and Wageningen University and Research. Still in 2021, he has been named Fellow of the Prognostics and Health Management Society, a world-recognized scientist in the area of reliability-centered, condition-based, and predictive maintenance. His research focuses on the modeling of failure repair maintenance behavior of components and complex systems for the analysis of the reliability, maintainability, prognostics, safety, vulnerability, resilience, and security characteristics, and on the development and use of Monte Carlo simulation methods, artificial intelligence techniques, and optimization heuristics. He is author and co-author of 7 books and more than 500 papers on international journals, chairman and co-chairman of several international conferences, associate editor of several international journals, and referee of more than 20. In this lecture, he will dare to state how risk assessment and management can become even more intelligent than it currently is, and underline the main characteristics that the approaches must have to make risk assessment and management intelligent. He will then address some research and development directions that are emerging in the area of risk assessment and management, supported by knowledge management and intelligence development. Before I hand over the dais to our distinguished speaker, I would like to inform the house that they can raise their questions through chat box. Commander Jetli sir, who will be acting as the moderator, will have the final say in selecting the questions and putting up to our dignified speaker. I now request our dignified speaker to commence his talk. Handing over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you to the organizers and the team for inviting me, and congratulations for this very good series so far. Okay, until today, it was a very interesting series. The only fault maybe that I can see on the organizers in stating my curriculum is that the most important thing was left out, my famous skills in soccer. As you can read here, this is a small a football team picture for some time ago, and I was said to be the last great number 10 player in Italy after Roberto Baggio, who was the divine ponytail. Okay, but I guess unfortunately I cannot show you my soccer skills in remote, so I will stick with the lectures, and I will like to focus in particular on the intelligence that can be put into maintenance through the analysis of data. And therefore, I will briefly go through the idea of maintenance and the connection with the prognostics and health management, open up the approaches, the different approaches that you have with prognostics and management, and then focus on those data-driven prognostics and health management models and approaches, in particular based on machine learning, artificial in general. We show you a couple of snapshots of results, maybe some more advanced ones, and then reach to some, I would say, intense conclusions on where we are with this today. Now, when we talk about maintenance, okay, all industry, I think, is after the dream of doing the ideal maintenance, of exploiting as long as possible the usage of our equipment and our components, okay, especially the critical ones like glasses of wine. I mean, glasses of wines are very, very critical, at least in Italy, okay? Wine is one of the most important things in Italy, so we need to take care of our glass and make sure that it doesn't fail. So we love to do maintenance just right before it breaks, okay? However, we are all very familiar with the fact that the time to failure of a glass, okay, is just uncertain. Any component fails at a given time, but we're just not able to see exactly at what time it will fail. And that's why we typically describe the uncertainty associated with the failure times with probabilistic frameworks, fuzzy frameworks, interval frameworks, and so on. This makes the maintenance decision a non-trivial one, because we're taking a decision under uncertainty on when the failure will occur. And this uncertainty has been dealt with in the history of industry, okay, development, with different types of approaches. In the early ages, there were, you know, just corrective maintenances. I mean, we just were waiting for a component, a unit to fail, and then we would start the repair then. Of course, back then, the mass production was limited, the components and equipment were not so spread out and so critical for the lives of societies. And from a certain point on, with the increase of industrialization of the world, there's been a need of planning when to best make maintenance in order to avoid failures, in order to respect the budget that is available for performing maintenance and operating the systems. So of course we're all very well familiar, even some of us in our daily lives, of scheduled maintenance. So, you know, maybe some of you take take the car in the shop to check every certain amount of times or a certain amount of kilometers or miles drone. Now, in the latest years, there's been a lot of interest in trying to base the maintenance strategy on as much knowledge as possible on the actual and future state of the components. This leads us to what is called condition-based maintenance, with the idea of bringing in, through data collection, through image collection, through even text inspection reports or inspection text reports, as much information as possible that tell us if our component is doing well or not, and then based on this, our maintenance, or even using these data, images, and textual state assessments to predict the future evolution of the degradation process of the life of the component in order to establish when it can be expected to do maintenance in a sort of predictive maintenance, which is centered around the prediction of the remaining useful life. And these particular types of condition-based and predictive maintenance are supported by what the community in jargon calls prognostics and health management. Now, this is quite an interesting area of development today in industry, and therefore also in science and research, because it's strongly linked to the hopes of the what we call the fourth industrial revolution, Industry 4.0, okay, which brings together a number of technological advancements, including digitalization, among the others, cloud computing, robotics, augmented reality, and cyber physical systems. And in particular, big data coming from digitalization and the strong computing power coming from cloud computing enables the opportunity of doing the prognostics and health management, supported by the advancement in data analytics in general and machine learning and artificial intelligence in particular, to enable condition-based and predictive maintenance. Now, prognostics and health management is really setting up what maybe we can call a medical team, okay, a medical equipe, okay. The idea, you're very familiar with that, is to equip your device and your units with some sensoring possibilities for monitoring a number of relevant physical parameters that are manipulated in certain mathematical ways to enable three tasks of the doctor, okay, in the medical team. The detection of an illness, okay, of a fault, an anomaly, to make sure that an alarm is sent out if there's something that's different from normal behavior of the components. The recognition of what's different, what's going on, what is the anomaly, okay, to enable the proper medicine, okay, the proper care and the proper repair, and to give the prognosis of the illness, okay, the prognosis of the anomaly, so that we know how long we have, what is the remaining useful life, in order to take the decision on when to act, okay, when to take action for the maintenance in the most effective way. And data-driven methods are quite strong and powerful based on artificial intelligence and machine learning and the like. So for what I said, of course, condition-based maintenance in particular is basing the decision on maintenance to contrast the developing or occurred failure. It's basing it on a monitoring module that feeds the information for the decision, okay? So maybe you are monitoring the creep in a slab, okay, in a material, and you have detected that something is happening, there is a micro creep or a crack that's developing, and you're following it in time, maybe with automatic inspection or so with electronic sensors, or by inspection, okay, by stopping and checking the for example, the turbine blades at certain times. And there is a threshold of where you declare the failure of the component, and you want to make sure that you do the maintenance before with sufficient margin to not incur in a catastrophic failure. With prognostics, okay, with predictive maintenance, you need to add an extra capability besides monitoring to collect information from the component and from its sensors. You need to build the capability of predicting the remaining useful life, RUL, because it's based on this remaining useful life prediction that you're taking the decision on when to act with maintenance. So the doctor now is clear, okay, it's arriving at defining the detection of normal or degraded conditions, diagnosing what's going on, even maybe predicting, okay, and then the key is how do we use these results, okay, to take the optimal maintenance decision. So there is a decision analytic step, an optimization step, which is quite relevant, and it's informed by our PHM analysis. And of course, it is driven by the classical drivers, okay, KPIs of safety, cost saving, availability, and so on, business continuity, and so on. Now, as for the PHM approaches, the prognostics and health management approaches, okay, there are two main families with also the possibility of hybridization, okay? If you pay enough, Professor Zio, he might be able to build you a model that with mathematical equations based on the physics describes the process of degradation of your component. And also, if you pay him a little bit more, he might give you also model that relates what you are measuring to the degradation indicator, the health indicator that you're using in your physics-based model. So this would be a model-based approach, which of course needs to be fed by information on what is the current degradation that you're following, what is the threshold that you're assuming for the failure, and any external operational conditions that need to be accounted for in your model. However, as you imagine, both for the complexity of the components and systems today, and also because of the complexity of the degradation processes and of the external and operational processes that influence these degradation processes, building models, mathematical, physics-based mathematical models is that are sufficiently close representation of reality is becoming more and more of a challenge. On the other hand, as we have been introducing up to now, there is a lot of opportunities from all this collection of state information on the components, equipment, and systems. So that are coming from sensors, that are coming from images, as I said before, and even from inspection text reports. So the data-driven approaches are quite fascinating, okay? If you think about the model-based, of course, you got the classical time series analysis techniques like Kalman filtering and its extension, and they're more powerful, although computationally intensive particle filtering. On the data-driven part, you have all the, I would say, army of empirical methods and all the artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques. We're going to focus on the data-driven methods, which are quite looked at with a lot of hope by industry, okay, today, and quite explore with the great innovations by researchers, and many I've seen in the audience today, and I thank them for taking some time to get bored with my lecture, because you already know everything, okay, of this. So what is machine learning and how does it comes into the picture of PHM or machine learning, artificial intelligence in general? Okay, well, okay, you know, the key is building a model, okay, for the behavior of our system. Take for example an engine like this, and you want to know a variable, okay, for example its torque, based on a number of inputs that you know and you can measure, like current, voltage, magnetic field, and temperature, and you want to build the functional relation in modeling terms, okay. And we are, as engineers, physicians, physics, mathematics experts, we are trained to try to build a physical model and express it in mathematical terms, and find the torque as a function, as an explicit function, and then maybe we need to solve it by numerical methods. That's okay. Okay. Now I was saying, the world is complex. Okay, and we're having a hard time more and more to describe the processes that involve our complex systems, okay, under all kinds of variable conditions, operational and environmental. So now the idea of machine learning is to actually tackle the challenge of being unable to build the exact form of the functional relation, okay, and approximate it empirically. Through a process which is called training, okay? So having a brain that is able to manipulate examples of data from the input and corresponding data from the output, okay, to build an empirical relation between these two sets of input and output, okay? So really, we are approximating the function, okay, through that mentioned training or learning algorithm, okay, where you're very well familiar with a number of types of machines or artificial intelligence algorithms that are iteratively presented with examples of the inputs and the output corresponding, okay, and they are asked based on the input to provide an estimation of the output, okay, and then based on the difference between the or the error that is made, okay, correct the parameters of the of your model, okay, in order to reduce the error. So this is typical also, I would say, professor-student training relation, okay. Give a number of lectures to show the output, how is it obtained by the input, correcting any mistake that the student is doing, okay, so that he gets ready for the exam. And it's a matter of the professor being good, okay. Let's not claim the students all the time. It's the professor being good. Students have to be patient and put their time into the training, but then the result will be good. And once the student is trained, once the algorithm is trained, it's ready to use, okay? So you can test the student, or you can actually use the model with data for which you don't have the output and you want the output because you finally put your artificial intelligence or machine learning machine or algorithm online on your component to predict the degradation, to detect the faults, to diagnose the failures, okay? So from what I've been describing, of course, it's clear that machine learning or artificial intelligence can build models to treat pattern recognition models. And in particular, we're interested in recognizing anomalous patterns from nominal behavior. So we want to have a machine that reads these inputs, okay, and has built the approximated functional relationship with the output, and it is capable to tell us that as long as the curve is green and is going upward, the engine is working fine, okay? And it's also able to recognize that when the input is having a red curve like that, then there's something wrong, okay? So it's the doctor reading the examination results, okay, the input that it's receiving. Other type of problem that we want for our purposes also of prognostics and health management for maintenance, of course, is data classification. Okay, again, we're measuring the data from the component, okay, and we'd like to build and have built the functional approximation, functional relation approximation that allows us to recognize different families, different clusters, okay, of behavior represented by the measured signals. So that if the point in the three-dimensional space of the measured signals falls in the green family, we can be happy and say, okay, we can go on and continue the operation of the component because it's doing fine. And then we can alert ourselves for damage or failed in case we see this point of operation drifting towards the more dangerous areas. Of course, machine learning artificial intelligence can solve classical signal or time series problems of regression, okay, with the data measured at a given time, building the functional relationship for the unknown variable at the same time. And this is the classical, nowadays it's nice to use fashionable buzzwords, okay? This is the classical frame of virtual sensors, okay? So we're building actually an algorithmic sensor, okay, that is capable of reconstructing the value of the variable that we cannot measure based on the measurements of the variables that we can do measure, okay? And then finally, okay, the prediction power, okay, that we want to do in particular predictive maintenance to do the prognostics of the remaining useful life. So now the challenge is based on the time series of your inputs, okay, try to build a functional relationship with the evolution in time, for example, of a particular parameter like the remaining useful life, okay, in time, which as each second of life of the component that goes by, the remaining useful life reduces of 1 second, okay? So it's a straight line that goes down in time. And you're trying to predict it, okay, with the proper uncertainty assessment as well, in terms, for example, of confidence interval. Okay, now some simple, really snapshots of these types of problems that machine learning can solve, positioned in the predictive maintenance tasks of prognostics and health management. So the idea is, all right, you know, let's get our data from the components and systems which are equipped with sensors, okay? Let's manipulate them because data is too big and not all is relevant. It's time series. We're collecting a lot of data on the components and systems. So let's try to get from this data what's interesting. Let's try to get out what's interesting. What's interesting for our purposes. So let's try to, first of all, synthesize the data with some features, which can be, for example, statistical feature like variance, skewness, peak, and using wavelets and all that, okay? Let's then still try to select among these characteristics of the shape of the curves of the trends of the data. Let's get out those which are most interesting for our purposes. So let's do a feature selection, which can be a filter feature selection like PCA or others, or it can be a wrapper approach where you put the selection of the feature within an optimization through a model, okay? And with these finally selected features, okay, which are representing at best the content of information that is interesting for our purposes, then we can finally go and build and train the model, which could be artificial neural networks, support vector machines, local Gaussian processes, whatever is best fit for the purposes. And once it's trained, okay, then it can perform the different tasks, okay, whatever model you use, either for detection, diagnostics, and prognostics, okay. And luckily, you know, to proceed from the collection of data to the GEM, the expertise, okay, in all the tasks. And I say luckily because then, you know, we do get work to do, okay, in terms of research to improve how to do it, and in terms of services and collaborations with the industrial partners, okay. Now, one example, in a work done in collaboration with the Halden Reactor Project in Norway, okay, it's an international project on nuclear energy, and we had a large amount of data from a nuclear power plant in Sweden, coming from 752 sensors, so that was a lot of data, okay, 1 year data sampled every 10 minutes, and the idea was to build a fault anomaly detection, okay, find anomalies when they were occurring, okay, based on very small deviations of the signals. So for this, we built a model of the plant in normal operation when everything was going well. We built a model that would give us how the signal would look like under normal operation. Okay, given the input that are measured, it would reconstruct how they should look like when everything is okay. And we build the model by using auto-associative kernel regression, okay? And then now we have data that is being collected, okay, really on the plant, and we can provide the data which is reconstructed as in normal operation by the algorithm. The difference between these will tell you very early if there is a problem, okay? And this is an example of one signal. The small dots are the signal how it should look like, but the sensor actually was showing an anomaly, okay? So if the signal was normal, it would look like the dotted lines, black dotted line. The sensor measured that there was something wrong because there was a difference. Of course, we were not measuring the dotted lines. We had to see how could we reconstruct, and we reconstructed the blue line to represent our trained model output of how that signal should look like if the plant was working fine. And from the difference, of course, you can detect that something is going wrong. Okay, remember the black dots, you don't see them. Okay, we had them because we were testing the trained model. Okay, but you actually are not measuring. You're measuring only the red line, you're reconstructing the blue line. If there is a significant, statistically significant difference, then you alert that something is wrong. And then, of course, we also had other approaches, for example, in terms of diagnostics, okay, very interesting work performed with the Electricité de France, okay. A lot of anomalies occurring and being able to be detected in during the shutdown of turbines, okay. So we had 149 shutdown of nuclear power plants, measuring 5 signals related to the operational conditions, okay, and 7 signals directly related to the turbine state. Based on these 12 signals, okay, in time, we were asked to help distinguishing different behavior during shutdown, and then with the expert help, find the root causes for that. So we built a quite sophisticated clustering approach to handle this data, okay? And we were able to find 5 different classes of behavior of the turbines, okay? 1 healthy and 4 malfunctioning. And this was found to be very, very useful. And with the experts, we were able to reconstruct what was the particular anomaly that was occurring, and it was making that particular deviation of type 1 or that particular deviation of type 2, 3, and 4. Okay, very good for then supporting the decision making on what to do on the anomaly. And finally, of course, as I mentioned, remaining useful life. This is an example of a work done on a turbine by some measured window measured signals, okay, that were then used and manipulated by machine learning to distinguish the time development of the degradation of the turbine from healthy to severely degraded. And based on this trend identification, okay, we were able to predict the remaining useful life. Now, some, I would say, hopefully slightly advanced examples. Okay, I took two examples, one related to turbofan engines and one related to bearings. Okay, these are two classical problems also in literature. One is concerned with the prediction of the remaining useful life, and the other one is concerned with the fault detection in bearing. Okay, now for the first problem, okay, we used echo state networks. Echo state networks are quite powerful neural networks, okay, for fast calculation and accurate prediction. Okay, they have the classical neural network type of structure, input, let's say hidden or internal units, and then output. Okay, the very interesting part is the parts are that, first of all, there is a reservoir, so it's part of the so-called reservoir computing, a reservoir of randomly connected network nodes, okay, with random connections, and each connection has a weight value. These are the parameters of the network, of course, and some of the nodes have a filter structure, so they feed back their own value, okay, so that there is an intrinsic dynamics in the representation by the model of the process, and in fact it's a time series dynamic process that we're looking at. And then the so-called readout, okay, from the output of the reservoir to the actual output of the network, which in our case was the remaining useful life prediction. The readout is simply linear, okay, and it's very quick to compute by linear algebra, okay. So in spite of the simplicity of the readout weights, okay, readout structure, you get the nonlinear modeling from the internal units, you get the memory property thanks to the feedback, and intrinsic dynamic. Okay, and actually, we applied for this case an ensemble, the development of an ensemble of echo state networks. This is a quite interesting framework of developing artificial intelligence and machine learning solutions. It's like having a team of doctors, not just relying on one doctor. Each echo state network is a team. It's a doctor. So it has to have some slightly different or some different characteristics than the others. Okay. And each of them gives you a prediction, an output, and then you need to combine the output. And it turns out, and there's a lot of studies on this, that both empirically and also theoretically, the combination of trained, multiple trained artificial intelligence models, okay, properly generated and properly trained, it's more accurate than the most accurate of the individual models. And also it gives you the possibility of saying something on the uncertainty of the model itself, because each of these models has some uncertainty associated to the empirical aspects that you're putting inside, okay, and the estimation of the weights, okay, through the training and so on. So we did take the turbofan engines. Actually, we to take data from a well-known database and built the ensemble echo state networks. Okay, the well-known data set is the CMAPS data set. Okay, where there are 260 run to failure trajectories of all the signals measured on the turbofan, 21 measured signals, and 3 are operating are related to operating conditions. Okay, the operating conditions, there are 6 different operating conditions, so you need to also make sure that you account for the operating condition, which might influence the patterns of the run to failure trajectories. There is a data manipulation, of course, to be done at the beginning. The data, you might get it this way, it needs to have some sort of health indicator trend, either increasing or decreasing, so that it can bring you some information on a process of degradation, of moving towards an unhealthy condition. Okay, we did, as we mentioned, an ensemble of neural networks or echo state networks. Okay, and the ensemble was built by taking 70 run to failure trajectories for training, but feeding only a subset taken by bootstrap, okay, to the different individual echo state networks. So, for example, echo state network one was built based on a training that was seeing these trajectories, 2, 15, 24, 54, and 68. Begging set 2 was 5, 11, 44, 54, 55, and was used to train echo state network 2, and so on. So each echo state network sees only a part of the universe, I would say, of behavior of the degradations that you have available from the run to failure trajectories. Okay, and so each of them has a, builds a slightly different idea of how to predict the remaining useful life. Now, so this was for generating the different doctors, okay, the echo state networks. How do we combine their predictions? Well, now we are interested in the prediction of the remaining useful life for the degradation of the turbofan, our turbofan, the turbofan that we are actually using or observing, and that's the red line, okay. Now, we have all these blue lines that we have used for the training of the different echo state networks. So based on the current degradation trajectory of interest, okay, we go and find the closest, okay, up to the point where we are observing the current degradation, the closest, the most similar trajectories, okay? Then we go and see the echo state networks that we have trained, how do they perform in terms of error on the remaining useful life prediction for these trajectories for which we know the end of life, because they are run to failure trajectories. So we go and see that for the most similar trajectory to the one that I am interested in, my degradation trajectory, echo state network makes this error, echo state network 2 makes this error, and so on. For the second most similar trajectory, the first echo state network makes a small error, the second one makes a very large error, and so on. So we got all these performances of the echo state networks on the most similar trajectories to my trajectory. It's like going to check how good is the doctor for the case, for the illness case that I'm suffering, for what I'm experiencing, for my symptoms, okay? Then I estimate the average local error, okay? Out of all these similar trajectories, similar to my illness, how good is echo state network 1? How good is echo state network 3? How good is echo state network H, okay? What is the error in this type of illnesses? Who is expert and who is less expert on that particular illness? Okay, and then we build a weight, which is the normalized reciprocal of the error made. So now, for example, for the current degradation that I'm observing, echo state network 1 seems to be quite good, okay, compared to echo state network 2 and also to echo state network H. And then I take the remaining useful life predicted at this time by echo state network 1 and I weight it by 0.52, the echo state network remaining useful life prediction, and I weighted by 0.19, and so on. And I build a weighted sum of the remaining useful life. Okay, weighted average because it's normalized. Okay, and this is the result. Okay, red dashed line is the remaining useful life, which is going down. Each second that passes by, the turbofan engine has a 1 second less to live, okay? This is the best single echo state network test. And this is the team of doctors, okay? Aggregated the way that I told you. So quite good results. Now for the fault detection with the, we use deep neural networks. I go back to the PLEED that you still need me and all the great researchers and colleagues that are attending this series and are contributing to this series, because we need to do all this work, okay, of feature extraction, feature selection, model training. Actually, deep learning is working against us in a certain sense, okay, because it does, you can combine, okay, the whole phase from the data to the task through a deep learning, like deep neural networks, deep belief network, convolutional network, and so on. Okay, and the idea is the idea of autoencoders. Okay, so of structuring a model, okay, which processes the whole data and projects it in representations that are made by smaller dimensions. So here you got a four dimensional data, okay? Here you go to three and eventually to two, okay? Throughout encoders. And then you take the representation that you want, which is typically the most compacted one, because the representation that you get at the end has the same amount of interesting information for you. So it's done the feature extraction and the feature selection, let me say automatically. It's got the same information content that you need that is in the original data. And so you can attach here now a layer for your fault detection, your fault classification, your fault prediction, okay? And you train the whole thing in a precise way. So the autoencoder, what it really does is trying to squeeze and compress the information in the data, okay? And it does it by autoencoding it. They used to be called auto-associative neural networks, okay? You take the input and you want a model that reproduces with accuracy the same values in input, okay? So your output must be as close as possible as the input. Going through lower dimensional representations, okay? This means then that if you get a good approximation here of the data that's in input, the two nodes in the middle are containing the same information, because you're getting this output from the information that comes out from these two nodes, okay? And the idea is to stack on top of each other a number of these autoencoders. You got large data, okay, for example, 2000 data. You're gonna go through a layer of 1000 and you say, okay, with the 1000 I reproduce very well these 2000 data. Let me take the 1000 and see if with 300 I can reproduce this 1000. Let me take the 310. Wow, that means that I can just stack them together, and from the 2000 I have representation on a 1000 dimensional space, 300 dimensional space, 10 dimensional space, and I'm able to reproduce the whole thing. Now I take just one slice. I take the slice that stops at the bottleneck layer 10, I attach to it a layer because I want to do classification, so a classification model, because I want to do a prediction, so a predictive model, and I got my beautiful deep neural deeply trained or deep learned model. Okay, here it is, classification layer. Okay, beautiful. We applied it to maybe I can go a little bit faster here, just not to bore you too much. We applied it to bearing data, okay? Quite a large number of data. We had 20,000 samples collected every 10 minutes, okay? We were taking snapshots of these, okay? And we built a good autoencoder stacked, okay? First, we manipulated the data and built a frequency spectrum, and we were able to reconstruct the same spectrum in output with this stacking of autoencoders, okay? And eventually add the classification layer and get the label of degradation reached by the bearing, okay? And this is the result. The blue line is our classification of the level of the health indicator, the degradation indicator, okay? And the true label is the red one. All right, so if you have survived, I will come to the conclusions. Actually, by stating some of the challenges and maybe flying quickly on some of the most advanced techniques, However, some of them I already mentioned it, so it's not worth it maybe to go and spend too much time there. The mother challenge of all, guys, is to try to do predictive operation and maintenance for the improvement of the overall use and performance of our system. So, okay, build the doctor. That's what we've been explaining today, okay? But also build the capabilities of predicting the demands on the on your system, predicting the, are you seeing my presentation or not? Because I'm seeing other things. Okay, predicting the demand, organizing based on the prediction of the demand and based on the prediction of the failures, organizing all the logistics that comes behind, because now you're in with condition-based and predictive maintenance, you're in for dynamic maintenance. It's not scheduled every 6 months, every year, so that you can organize your spare parts and your mechanics and all that. It's when it's ready and it's needed, you got to do it. So you got to have, you know, an on-demand response to the request for maintenance, okay? And so the idea is, with all the information that you can take out and predict on the state of the components and on the future demand and on what you need, okay, optimize really operation and maintenance. This is the mother challenge in industry today, okay? And again, it's a matter of the big kid. This is my big claim, okay? I say that we don't only have big data, we have big knowledge because we also have models. We still have some professors, okay, that we can still do some models that are useful. We get a lot of maintenance logs, safety reports, and so on, which contain with natural language text, which is relevant to how the component behaves, how it's degraded, and so on. We got data and images. Okay, we said that we can build machine learning and train and so on for that. So our big kid is becoming smart and it should enable us to predict the right time to do the maintenance, accompanied by the forecasting of everything else, okay? Perhaps through some optimization modules like reinforcement learning, which is extremely powerful, again, computationally expensive, so that not only you predict when it's time to do the maintenance, but also you predict what you need to do best in terms of operation, logistics, and maintenance, okay? Now, there's all kinds of challenges. I don't want to waste too much of your time. Of course, data, it's always a problem in practice, okay? You need data to feed. The idea case is, okay, I got example of healthy components, degraded components, and they're all labeled, so I know everything, okay? Not. That doesn't happen in practice, okay? Sorry. You got all kinds of missing information. Sometimes you only have healthy data. Why? Because unfortunately, engineers design and build components do not fail, and the failures are rare, degradations are rare, they're taken care of, okay? So you only have all healthy data, so you need to unsupervise your methods, okay? Or sometimes you have surely healthy components and degraded components, but nobody was able to put the labels on, okay? You only have the measurements from the sensors of the variables, but not the labeling of, okay, this is healthy, this is degraded 5%, this is degraded 10%, this is degraded 70%. And sometimes you only have data, okay, at certain events. When an anomaly occurs, you have the black box that takes the picture of what's happening, okay? You don't have the continuous tracking of the data. Also, you are building your models for components that live for a long time, and the environment, the operation, and the component itself changes. So the environment, the context is changing. Your model that you have trained on a database at the beginning is no longer representing properly the trends of degradation, the healthy behavior. The cloud in the multidimensional space of the variables, the cloud that characterized the LT and LT and so on moves in time, drifts in time. So you need to adjust, you need to update, you need to make adaptive your model, okay? More and more, you want to know what's inside your machine learning artificial intelligence methods and algorithms, particularly for critical applications, okay? Safety critical applications. These algorithms, you know, are black boxes. We always say it, they're black boxes. We want to make them at least gray, as white as possible. There's a big effort here, I go very fast here, on using methods to build interpretable machine learning models, okay? Methods that look at the data and try to interpret as much as possible the input, methods that look at the output through sensitivity analysis and try to understand as much as possible what relation is finally was built inside the machine learning, okay? By sensitivity analysis of output with respect to the input. And also methods that are trying to inject physics and transparency inside the model itself, okay? By specific techniques, including changes in the error models, in the cost function that enables the training, okay? I'll skip this for. And then last but not least for the challenges, start being worried about the security of the algorithms themselves, okay? The security of the algorithms themselves. We can, hackers can train our machine learning models in a bad way. They can actually hack our models. And then we will get outcomes, outputs from the models, which are not representative of what's really happening. And we take decisions based on that, okay? I will fly on frontiers, just mentioning them. I talked to you about eco-state networks. They are in the family of extreme learning machines. Deep neural networks, extremely powerful. We've seen them, convolutional neural networks for, in particular, image processing. Generative adversarial networks, extremely interesting for detection, okay? And all the transfer learning, the optimal transport from one learning to another to get the best out of all the learnings is extremely important for practical application. I'm sorry that I don't have time probably to go through this, and I don't want to bother you too much. I want to remain in time. This, you already seen them, convolutional neural networks. And so I guess the good thing is, and this is the commercial break at the end of the talk, okay, the advertisement, a number of these visions, reflections, experiences maybe, okay, are being collected in a mind frame, if you wish, in a couple of papers here, one more general, one on the current current situation of PHM and one on the perspective for industry. Finally, I thank you for your attention. Ooh, I barely made it. I thank you for your attention. Of course, you're more than welcome to contact me for anything. Thank you. I cannot hear anybody. I hope you're still there.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, now you are.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Enrico Zio, for the very nice and in-depth presentation on the various techniques and challenges which are used for the machine learning and PHM. And there are some of the questions from the participants who has written in the meeting chat. So I will take up one by one. So hope you are okay now with your throat is okay so that we can take up the question.
Okay, we can try.
Yeah. Yes, so first question from the Priyo Goswami. The question is there any thumb rule to determine threshold for failure in any component or machine or system while finding RUL?
Yeah, this is one of the key, I would say, practical problems in the use of PHM for maintenance, both condition based and predictive, and it's really a matter of expertise by the industrialist and by expertise by a component manufacturer with respect to the performance that is expected and its relation to certain parameters like temperatures and others. Okay, so from a safety point of view, usually it's okay. I mean, you know that I hear, maybe we can turn off the microphone because I hear a lot of noise in the background. Thank you. So you know that certain materials reach some melting temperatures and you need to stay below with a certain safety margin. So some of the thresholds can be put with reference to certain physical properties, but it's not easy. And of course, experience and the fact of having observed, if you have observed, you know, degradations and failures in previous use, will give you the information needed to set the thresholds. You want me to continue with the questions? The next question, I think, is from Son Teacher One. Thank you for the question. Out of classification and regression, which approach works better for predictive maintenance? It really depends on what you have as data. For the prognostics part, if we think about time series analysis, then recurrent models, of course, are more are fitter, okay? Recurrent neural networks and these types of methods, because they include in their modeling itself the dynamics and the memory of the process. Biswait Sau for the, and sorry for my pronunciation, of course, for the OKG nuclear power plant example, true data is not known. So from the measured data, how is there a contrasted signal? Yes, now maybe I didn't say it very clearly. I remember I said it, but at the very end, you remember that the black dotted line, that's because when we were developing the method, we were also given the true value, okay? So we were given the true value, okay? And then with a simulator, we were able to generate the sensor anomalous data, okay? So it was injected, the difference, and then we went back to recognize. That's something that's typically done to set up the fault detection or the anomaly detection model. Okay, in case of the unlabeled data, the question is by Ashutosh Bishwal. In case of the unlabeled data for the clustering, with Electricité de France, yes, we did interpret the clusters with the support of the EDF engineers, okay? And they were looking at the signals, the signals that were measured, yes. Mutuganapati, okay. Please mention few machine algorithms that will give a close match of remaining useful life. How to select the algorithms? Again, there's a need of, you know, experience, and there's a need of seeing what data you have available. There are data that there are methods that need more data to give you more accurate results. There are methods that suffer certain things. In general, for remaining useful life and for prediction, also therefore predictive maintenance, I would suggest anyway to look at reservoir at recurrent models and also models that give you an uncertainty evaluation too, because you're predicting, okay? So local Gaussian processes and things like this give you also the uncertainty of your prediction. That's important to have confidence. Okay. Chatanaya Jakati, how to deal with the missing data? Okay. Yep.
Yeah, maybe we can take one more last question.
Okay. Okay, you choose them because I don't want to bias.
maybe that I will take up, or you can take this question that how to deal with the missing data also okay. When it comes to mentioned data, our workshop. Yeah.
Right. Okay, well, I mean, when you have missing data, there are various ways to handle missing data. Okay, now, some typically are interpolation techniques that can become quite sophisticated, okay, in order to make the best interpolation without adding excessive additional information that's not there, okay. And of course, the maintenance data that's collected from tests and so on, it's also quite important and needs to be included, okay, in the KID, as I say, the knowledge information data that needs to be elaborated for a more accurate description of the component's degradation and therefore a more accurate prediction. And this is done with some hybrid methods that can combine the time series data collected, the text, even the text reporting of inspections and maintenance, the test data from maintenance, images from pictures and so on. So there's a lot of advancements in order to try to make the fusion of all this information in order to give the most accurate possible results in your analysis upon which you base your decisions. Thank you.
Sir, and now I would like to invite Professor RN Rai to offer the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Professor Hiral, and thank you, sir. I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to Professor V.K. Tiwari, sir, Director at IIT Kharagpur, and Sri Subir Chowdhury, Chairman and CEO AISI Consulting Group, LLC USA, for providing their kind blessings. I would also like to thank Professor Retired K.B. Misra, sir, IIT Kharagpur, and internationally acclaimed Academician Reliability Group and founder of erstwhile RSC, for his everlasting blessings. And definitely Professor Enrico Zio for delivering today's talk as a distinguished speaker. I also extend my thanks to Commander V.K. Jaitley, Chairman C-Cube Consultants, New Delhi, and Member Advisory Committee for SCSQR for being QA moderator, and Professor Pradhan for his kind presence. Last but not the least, I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to all participants and Team SCSQR for their continued support in making this event a grand success. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for the opportunity. It was a pleasure and honor.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.